Titus chapter 2, picking up at verse 9, and really verses 9 and 10, if we were to outline this book, belong with the previous verses of the chapter. We just did not have the time last Sunday to include these verses in that message, but they are part of the bigger picture that we looked at last week. Namely, Paul is telling Titus how to instruct various groups in the society there on the island of Crete in terms of their behavior. Last week we looked at the older men, the younger men, the older women, the younger women, and now he's going to deal with the issue of slaves, those slaves who had become believers in Jesus Christ. And slavery, as we'll mention here in a moment, was very prevalent in the ancient Roman Empire. So, looking at verse 9, exhort bondservants to be obedient to their own masters, to be well-pleasing in all things, not answering back, not pilfering or stealing, but showing all good fidelity or faithfulness, so that they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior in all things. The instruction here, as it is with the other verses there in chapter 2, the reason for the instruction has to do with the witness, the gospel witness to the outsiders of the community of Crete. Remember, we're reading about a time where the Christian gospel of Jesus Christ was just beginning to penetrate the island. It was still pretty much an unknown belief system among the regular people. And in these early days, it was important that the witness of God be something that was not immediately shut down or closed off, because it already starts off as an incredible thing, doesn't it? We worship a crucified criminal of the state who we believe rose from the dead. I mean, just try to get that through to the average Roman mind in the Roman Empire. It's just unimaginable. Of course, that's a very simplistic way of putting it, I realize. But ultimately, isn't that what we're talking about when we speak about the cross? And so we have these verses. Now, commonly, in seeking some sort of application for our own lives of these verses, it'll be mentioned the relationship of the employer to the employee. And because of the way slavery was in the ancient world and how common it was, and the way the employment relationship exists today in terms of its commonplace, is the way typically work gets done, you hire somebody to do it, as opposed to work getting done by having slaves to do it. There is a little bit of a similarity, though obviously some differences as well that we'll talk about. But in terms of the similarity, if we think about Christian employees, and of course, if you guys are employees, then this hits home, doesn't it? The two things to avoid, Paul writes, is don't talk back and don't steal. Now, if you've ever been an employer, or maybe at least a supervisor, someone who oversees others, you know how frustrating it is when you try to say, hey, we got to get this done, so I need you to do this. Why do I have to do this? I always have to do this. Why don't you have to, you know, all the talk back stuff. It's just not a very good witness. And, of course, stealing should go without saying, and we're not talking about necessarily embezzling, you know, great sums of money from the cash register or something. But there's a lot of ways to steal on the job site. How about stealing just time? If we're there, whether we're being paid by the hour or being paid salary to get a job done, the idea is we are getting paid for our work. And it's very easy as Christians to let the conversation that began over the coffee break or over the lunch hour break into regular time, and so we think, well, I'm just witnessing for Jesus Christ for 2 hours here with my coworker who's very interested, and no one's getting any work done. And so how does that speak to the employer about what it means to follow Jesus Christ? And so, don't talk back, don't steal, but rather be someone who shows good faithfulness, fidelity. And that's wonderful. Again, if you're ever in that position of overseeing others, isn't it wonderful to know that I know that they're going to be faithful. They're going to show up on time. They're going to lock up okay. They're going to set the all the things that are part of the job site, part of faithfulness. I know that person always is dependable. What a witness for Jesus Christ that sort of person is. Now, as I said, though, the employer-employee relationship does fall far short of slavery and the evils of slavery. There are many people today who are quite condemning, very critical of the teachings of the Bible for not being more direct in saying that slavery should be completely outlawed, and therefore slaves, you should not seek to do the things like we just read, you know, obeying your masters, but rather you should rise up against your masters. And slave owners, you ought to let all your slaves go free if you're a follower of Jesus Christ. And so there's a lot of criticism that that's not in the Bible. And sadly, there have been Christians over the centuries, whether in Europe, whether in our country or elsewhere, that have used certain verses like these to defend the institution of slavery that they were personally profiting from and the evils thereof. Now, it's a very different thing to be critical of a professing Christian who seeks to twist or use the scriptures in a way to personally profit themselves from evil versus being critical of God's word itself. Because in being critical of God's word, one is really, in many ways, being critical of God himself. God, you should have done it differently. See, I come from a starting point that God knows more than us. I come from a starting point that God has a plan and a purpose that often doesn't seem to make a lot of sense at the first look. But then when we see the bigger picture, we say, oh, God, boy, you were smart all along, weren't you? You knew what you were doing. You see, in talking about this issue, and today's not going to be entirely about this issue, but we do need to say a few things. There's a lot of different verses in the scriptures about this. And one of the things that needs to really hit home that Paul says in one of his other letters, this one in 1 Corinthians, is basically that you remain in the calling in which you were called. If you were called as a slave, then you're a slave. If you can be made free, great. Seek your freedom. Obviously, freedom is far greater than slavery. But remember, he who's called in the Lord while a slave is free in the Lord. And by the way, if you're free in society, if that's your legal status in the Roman Empire, well, you're really Christ's slave, and that's how you should see yourself. See, it's not so much about your personal rights and all that. It's about how I serve the Lord by serving my fellow man and how I live according to the teachings of the Scripture. Now, it's important to recognize maybe why God wrote these things this way. First of all, the Roman Empire slavery was very, very different than the slavery that we know from our history or from Europe that was such a great evil. Slavery wasn't about going to a far-off land, ripping people out of their homeland, sticking them on a boat, and if they survived this terrible, torturous boat ride back to the mainland, being sold as property to people who then could use them and abuse them to whatever extent they want. That wasn't slavery in the Roman Empire. In the Roman Empire, one was a slave because basically your life was spared by the slave owner. Maybe it was war. Maybe it was an abandoned child in a field. So the mindset was this person wouldn't even be alive. And so life is usually preferable to death. And that was the basis in society. And it was massive. There was no counter voice. There's not one recorded writer, politician, philosopher, you name it, not one in the Roman Empire who ever wrote that slavery as an institution was wrong. Think about that. And compare that to Europe or the United States, where there's always a divide, always a division. Voices on both sides. It was completely accepted, completely the norm. There was discussion about how to treat slaves, yes, but the Bible tells you how to treat them. You treat them properly. You treat them right. You don't abuse them. You don't withhold things from them and so forth. One voice saying it should be outlawed. So what if the Apostle Paul was that lone voice? How would the gospel have ever gotten off the ground? How would it ever have gained traction? Would it have looked like a lunatic teaching, and it would have been discounted completely out of hand? And you know who knew that? God. God knew that. This was also a time when there weren't, you know, safety nets for people, food stamps or forms of welfare or whatever for people. So if you were able to work in a household where you could feed your family and things were pretty good for you, the idea of like, I want my freedom. Okay, fine. Now go try to find a job and go try not to starve and all that. It wasn't just a simple thing to do. So you can see how it was so massive in the Roman society. And this is all about being a witness for Jesus Christ. Why? So that the gospel could continue on. And notice again verse 10. In acting this way, we read that at the end of verse 10, that the slave may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior in all things, to adorn, to make beautiful. Well, in the ancient Greco-Roman world that we're talking about, this idea of adornment, which is something like we see today, often involved the very wealthy citizens of the society. And they would sponsor a beautiful art project there at City Hall or something spectacular for the temple or maybe a new building. And so they would pay the money for that. And then the mayor, the head of the city would come to them and he would say, oh, this is so wonderful. And it was the idea of an adornment of the city. And then they'd get all this public recognition. Same thing happens today. When a wealthy person donates $2 million to help build a special wing at the hospital, right? And they're going to open it up, and there's the wealthy guy, and he gets his name on the hospital, and they give him a key to the city, and there's the big scissors to cut the ribbon and all that stuff, right? All sorts of public recognition for your financial. Again, a slave had nothing, though. They had no ownership. There was no way that they could ever adorn anything in the ancient world with their money. But God says, in acting this way, you actually adorn something far greater than the city in which you live. You adorn the teaching of God our Savior in all things. And it was the teaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ that was going to change the Roman Empire. And it would change Europe. And it would change the United States. And in fact, in those places where the gospel advanced, slavery would be eventually eliminated. As far as accepted public, any sort of human trafficking, any sort of slavery that exists now is both illegal and underground, isn't it? It needs to be rooted out. And there are many people, including Christians, who are trying to root that out. Where you still see slavery as a norm in society or in places that are closed and dark to the gospel of Jesus Christ. In fact, sometimes it's the few Christians in those countries that end up being the slaves in such societies today. I want to close this thought with a great quote by Sir William Ramsay. Now, this guy was a tremendous archaeologist about 100 years ago who explored where Paul traveled, explored cities like Ephesus and Crete and these places, just did a lot of tremendous discoveries, and we owe a lot to him. And Sir William Ramsay wrote this: the spread of Christianity produced gradually a higher atmosphere of thought in which slavery cannot live. The more fully Christianity is realized in any society, the more thoroughly will slavery be destroyed. And that's exactly what time has shown over 2,000 years. And it's almost as if God knew what he was doing. Amen? So, the key thing was to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's exactly what leads to instructions like verses 9 and 10. If you want to criticize the European or American slave owner of a couple hundred years ago who wants to use the Bible to justify the evil and what is completely unjustified, that's fine. I'll criticize those people alongside, but we don't criticize God's word. God knows why he wrote what he wrote, and he knows the end from the beginning, and he knows the big picture. Now, let's move on. Verses 11 through 14 are one of those examples of Paul giving us one big sentence. He does this from time to time. So we'll look at it as a whole because it is one big sentence. Verse 11, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works." End of sentence. That's a long one, like I said. But boy, is there a lot there. The first thing that kind of jumps out at us is once more seeing that past, present, future aspect of salvation. The grace of God, verse 11 says, that brings salvation has appeared. The past, talking about Jesus Christ, of course, and his death on the cross. But then, verse 12, about how we live as believers in Jesus Christ, as his followers in this fallen world, and the denying of one thing, denying the ungodliness, denying the worldly lusts. And then not only what we don't do, but what we actually proactively do with our lives, we live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. But even in that, it's not just about this world and this life. We are looking to the future because there is a blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ still to come. It's not just about this life and this world. But you see that past, present, future aspect. And I do think it's important to notice in verse 11, the grace of God that brings salvation. Because when people hear about the grace of God, there is sometimes a natural tendency to think, well, you can't possibly believe that God just accepts you as you are because he's just loving and forgiving and all the rest and doesn't demand that you do some things. That's exactly what the Bible says. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. He did all the work. He loves us first. I just can't handle that. Yeah, grace is scary. And people want to kind of put the leash on God's grace sometimes, right? Well, yeah, God's grace, except you still got to do that, right? But see, here's the thing. The grace of God that brings salvation. Because I contend that anyone who has been born again, that has been touched by the grace of God in their life, that has received Jesus Christ and had the spiritual birth as their Savior, at that moment, you see, the Spirit of God indwells that person, and God's Spirit then changes you. You're a new creation in Christ, and that new creation is going to desire now to live a life pleasing to God. See, this is not some theoretical philosophy in the ivory tower. This is about the true and living God actually touching your life. Is there anyone who says, yeah, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, I think I can send up a storm and it's no big deal. I'm going out as soon as church is over. Hurry up, Pastor. Of course not. That's totally foreign from our minds, isn't it? We know how God teaches us how to live in this world, but that's the problem. We're still in this fallen world, and we still have these fallen, depraved bodies. Though indwelt, yes, by the power of the Spirit of God, nonetheless, we still have ungodliness and worldly lusts creep in. Lusts, desires, passions that are worldly. They're ungodly. We need to deny them. We also have a spiritual enemy that we know is Satan, who's all too happy and quick to begin to whisper in your ear and to tempt you to give in to some of those things. But we know that that's not how God wants me to live anymore. We know that God rather would wants me to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age, in this fallen world. And yet sometimes we do fall. Oh, and it's easy to be discouraged, isn't it, when we fall? And Satan loves our discouragement. And our discouragement can feed upon itself. And it's just like circling the drain and going downward in a spiral. Satan begins to whisper, how can you possibly think about going to church on Sunday after the way you lived this past week? Yet what do we read in the Bible? Let's not forsake assembling ourselves together as we read as part of our communion service, right? Let's stir up each other to love and to good works. It's all right, man. We're in God's house. We hear about God's forgiveness. We hear about God's love. We need that. And God's Spirit bears witness with our spirit. You're my child. Remember, we don't surprise God with anything that we do. We disappoint ourselves. I can't believe I did that. God says, I knew you were going to do that. But I love you anyway, my child. That's why Jesus died. But you see, if we let the discouragement get us and then we stay away and then we say, well, and then Satan says, and you certainly can't read your Bible, you hypocrite, you can't pray and all the rest of it, and there you start going down and down and down. We're living in sinful times, in sinful bodies, with the sinful angel known as Satan tempting us. But God is greater than all of that. But this is not the final stage. Again, the future, we are looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing. See, one day, we're going to be face to face with Jesus. Either he will return for us as a whole, as the church, or individually, you'll breathe your last breath here on this earth and you will die in the body, but when you are absent in the body, you will be present with the Lord. Because we're not ever going to die in the Spirit. Either way, we will know the glorious appearing, to be face to face with our Lord. Now we see through a mirror darkly, right? It's in part. But one day, all that darkness, all that lack of clarity, done away. Why? Because I did this and I forsake. Because of Jesus, what he's done for us. That's why. And I want to add something, and again, not to elaborate on it, but make a big mark, highlight, do whatever you got to do to verse 13 of chapter 2. Notice, hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. This is one of the clearest, most powerful verses in the entire Bible, making it very clear that Jesus Christ, yes, in fact, is God Almighty, God in human flesh. You hear people all the time, oh, you never said that, the Bible doesn't teach that, whatever. Right there. Now, real quickly, because we don't have time for a Greek lesson here, but I can assure you, as one who is familiar with the language, not necessarily those guys who knock on your door and they say, well, you know, buddy, in the original Greek. Like, oh, you want to talk about the Greek? Well, let's bring out the Greek. Well, wait a minute. Hold on. I can't even read the alphabet. Okay. But as someone who can read the alphabet and a little bit more than that, I can assure you that the Greek makes it very clear that only one individual is being discussed here by the way that it is written in the grammar. And again, I won't get into all the reasons why, because it'll just be Greek to you. No. But if someone tries to say, well, no, it's trying to talk about Savior, like God, he's separate, and then our Savior Jesus Christ, he's separate. No, that is specifically excluded from the way the language is written. Far from it. It's actually saying this is the same person. So remember this verse. It's a powerful one. Commit it to memory. And this God and Savior Jesus Christ is verse 14. He gave himself for us. He died for us. He loves us. And he purifies us. Like I said, oh, we disappoint ourselves, but we can't disappoint God because he knows the end from the beginning. And he still loves us. And he still washes us clean because it's on the basis of Jesus' work. It's God's grace that we are saved by through faith. Gift of God, not of works, so no one can boast. But at the same time, God makes us his special people, zealous now for good works. We are his workmanship, as we read earlier in the service, creating Christ Jesus unto good works that God foreordained that we would walk therein. Paul concludes the chapter to speak these things, exhort, rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you. And of course, our authority is rooted right there in the Word of God. Titus's authority rooted in the Apostle Paul's authority as an apostle of God, directly commissioned by the Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Savior. And he says, Titus, you have my authority as an apostle. You go preach those people in Crete, to Crete. Well, here we are with God's Word, studying God's Word, and the authority is right there in God's Word. It's not what Pastor Steve said today. Except to the extent that what Pastor Steve said today, I think, lines up exactly with what we were reading today, line by line. The authority of the Word of God, the finished work of the Son of God, the love of God to us all. Hold on to that this week. And live for your Lord one day at a time. Don't get discouraged. Don't get depressed. I think sometimes a lot of that is just homesickness. This isn't our home. I mean, if you feel at home in this world, you know, you turn on the news, I can't wait to watch the news. It's going to be great, you know. No. You grieve over the things that are going on in this world. Because it's a fallen, sin-cursed world. But God's not asleep up there. He's got a plan. He's got a... God, why don't you come back today and stop this? Well, one day, that prayer too will be answered. Maybe not in that form. You might, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Might be a little bit more spiritual to present it to God than right now, Lord. But just think about God's timing. Think about God's delays. Think about God's plan and purposes throughout the Scripture. That's why he gave us all that Old Testament history. That's why he gave us so much to understand he's always at work. He's always got a plan. He's always moving forward to that culmination. It took centuries and centuries and centuries to bring Jesus to this earth. He had his plan and his timing. Likewise, centuries and centuries growing the church, and one day, he will wrap everything up. He'll bring his judgment to those who have rejected him completely, and he'll set up his kingdom. Then we'll be home. Amen? And then we will be rejoicing. Hallelujah.